So if you look at the fundamentals of the combustion, combustion is defined as relatively rapid combination, chemical combination of hydrogen and carbon in the fuel with the oxygen in the air. So what is participating? Hydrogen and carbon from the fuel and air from the oxygen from the air, they combine. And this is exothermic reaction. So it leads to liberation of energy in the form of heat. So when this combine in the combustion chamber, heat is released. So what are the conditions necessary for the combustion? There are three main conditions which are necessary. The presence of a combustible mixture. When you say combustible mixture, what do you mean? Do you mean just any mixture, or mixture has to have certain strength? So mixture is required to have certain strength. There should be certain minimum air fuel ratio and certain maximum. You should be within that band. Okay? If you are outside that band, then the combustion will not take place. Okay? Then you need some means of initiation of combustion. How we initiate the combustion? So there should be some way to actually start the combustion. And then stabilization and propagation of flames in the combustion chamber. It's not necessary that if you ignite, the flames will continue. Flames may get extinguished. Okay? So it is necessary that the conditions inside the combustion chamber should be such that the flames once initiated should be able to consume the remaining charge in the combustion chamber and move all the way up to the cylinder walls, okay, in a stable manner. So in SI engine, the combustible mixture is generally supplied by carburetor and of course now by port fuel injection systems. Carburetors are used in very, very few applications now, again because of the emission norms. And the combustion is initiated by something called a spark plug. Spark plug is a device where you apply the spark. You have very high voltage applied around two electrodes, which are apart by about 0.75 millimeter. How much is the voltage? So voltage is, depending on the vehicle, it depends, it varies from 20 kilovolts to 35 kilovolts. 20,000 volts to 35,000 volts, depending on what vehicle you are using. So in a conventional spark ignition engine, the fuel and air are mixed together in the intake system. And then they are inducted into the cylinder via the intake valve. And then combustion is initiated towards the end of the compression stroke by electric discharge. So basically what you are doing is, in the spark plug, you apply the high voltage. So what happens is that the charge from one electrode jumps to the other. And this distance is very, very small. So in between these two, plasma is created. Okay. And this whole spark plug is in the fuel air mixture. So once this plasma is created, plasma is fourth state of the matter. Okay? Hot ionized gas. And that starts the combustion inside the fuel air mixture. So following the inflammation means start of the flames, a turbulent flame develops. Now you see this engine is moving all the time. You know, it's one cycle is about 15-20 milliseconds depending on what speed your engine is operating. Okay, so it's operating all the time, so there is no laminar condition, it's all turbulent. So once the turbulent flames are going to develop and then propagate through this essentially premixed charge, burnt gas mixture until it reaches the combustion chamber walls, and then once it reaches the combustion chamber wall, the flames are going to extinguish. See, the flames, if you look at the composition of the combustion chamber, in the combustion chamber you will have fuel, you will have air, and you will have residual gases from the previous charge. Why? Because the piston doesn't go all the way to the cylinder head. There is some clearance volume, right? That always is left with some residual gases from the previous cycle. So when the piston starts coming down, there is residual gas and then fresh air and fuel comes in. So you are always dealing with a mixture of fuel, air, and gases from the previous cycle, okay, right? And then you see when the flame propagation takes place, flames will go on. If you look at the walls are the place where on the one side of the wall you have combustion chamber, on the other side of the walls you have coolant. So valves are normally maintained at very low temperature, not very low, it's how low? So we try to maintain around between 90 to 105 degrees centigrade, 90 to 100, 90, 95, 100. Why? Because we don't want the water to boil out. Okay, that is one thing. The second is that in the cylinder walls, there is a lubricating oil layer. If the engine is running too hot, that layer may get washed out or that may be removed, it may burn out, and that will create a lot of wear related issues in the combustion chamber. So basically you are losing a lot of heat through the walls, and the heat is being released by flame propagation. So the flames will move and they will go very close to the cylinder walls as long as the net heat release is positive. That means the heat lost, heat generated by the flames minus the heat lost by the walls. They cannot go all the way to the walls. Flames never reach all the way to the walls. There will always be one stagnant layer, however thick it may be, 0.2 millimeter, 0.1 millimeter, where the flames will extinguish before that much distance from the walls. Now you see, I'm going to introduce very interesting concept to you here. This is the in-cylinder pressure diagram for the spark ignition engine. This is the top dead center. So obviously on this side you have the compression stroke. On this side you have the power stroke. Now you see, just don't worry about these three curves, just look at this one curve where 10 is written. So what you have done is, this is the motoring diagram so far, okay? If the motoring diagram is there, it will be like this. So what you have done is, in this you have applied the spark 10 degrees before the top dead center. So once you apply the spark, do you think the combustion starts immediately? No, because once the spark is applied, there will be some chemical reactions that will take place, and the flames will not be seen until you have sufficient momentum of these reactions build up. In this period again, you know, right from the application of start to the first time your firing curve starts deviating from the motoring curve, that means you have change in pressure, sufficient heat release or the flames are seen, that period is called ignition delay. So you have applied the spark here and you see the pressure does not rise, and after some time the pressure starts rising, and obviously by this time you see piston is already moving down. So your heat release takes place when the piston volume has increased. So the peak cylinder pressure will not be very high. Okay. Now this is the condition where you have applied at 30 degree. Suppose you have applied at 30 degree. This is just a typical example. Don't worry about these numbers, but just understand the concept. Suppose this is 30 degree. For 30 degree, this is the pressure. Suppose you say that, okay, I don't want this, I want to apply even earlier. So now you apply at 50 degree. So once you apply at 50 degree, so what happens is that the flames will start. Now flames will try to push the piston down, and piston will try to complete the compression stroke. So gas force is trying to push it down, piston is trying to come up. So there will be two forces which will be acting against each other. So here you see the top dead center, you have peak pressure very close to the top dead center. Okay. So now in these three situations, which one do you think will give you the best torque output? This one, or this one? The one with 30, the 10 will not give you best torque because already the piston has expanded. The effective work will be very, very small. So there is a parameter which we define, which is called maximum brake torque. Okay, so what we do is we do experiments at different spark advances, see which spark advance gives us the maximum torque, and then we write everything in terms of relative torque. That means divide everything with this maximum torque, and then we put the spark advance on the x-axis. So this kind of a curve comes out. Okay, so that means at 10 degree or 15 degree also you will have lot of reduction in torque. There will be some value which will give you maximum torque, and then if you advance your spark further, there will be reduction in the torque. So there will be some value which will give you maximum brake torque. And please also note here that this is not a really a peak, this is rather a flat, which is spread over 4 or 5 degrees. So it is all right if you are 1 or 2 degrees this side or that side. It's not really going to matter much in spark ignition engine. Okay, so this is a simple experiment that can be done to see what is the optimum spark timing. Now there is one question that was asked to me by one student in the last class, and I want to tell you again, you know, about the engine, there are so many processes that are happening in a very, very fast time scale. Okay, it is not possible for us to decipher everything. Why? We don't know the physical reason about everything that is happening inside the engine. Okay, so as a thumb rule that is practiced in the industry, we say that, you know, you have this top dead center here, your pressure is rising from here to here. We say that half of the pressure rise must have taken place at TDC, the remaining half should take place after the TDC, and that's how you define your optimum spark timing. This is a thumb rule. There is no scientific explanation for this, but this is something that is used in the industry. Half of the pressure rise should take place before the top dead center, half of the pressure rise should take place after the top dead center. Now you see, flame structure and flame speed, there are many, many studies which are done. So again, a special type of engines were made in which, you know, you had some kind of a optical visualization, and then people used high speed photographs to see how the flames are actually generating inside the engine. So you see, this is the crank angle degree from ignition. So this is 10 degree after the ignition has taken place, 15, 20 and 25. 10, 15, 20 and 25. And you see here, this is one combustion chamber where you have a side ignition. That means the combustion chamber ignition is at the side. So this is the flame front at 10 degree. This is the flame front at 15, this is 20 and this is 25. You can see that from here, the flame front is moving in this direction and there is no swirl condition. So you can see very quiescent, there is hardly any effect of turbulence or swirl on the flame front. Okay. Now the same thing is seen with normal swirl. That means there is swirl, there is some swirl in the combustion chamber. You ignite it. So now you see, it is moving on one side. It is moving on one side, and then you see with swirl, compared to this, your flame speed is faster, you are able to consume the charge much more. This is the zone where the unburnt charge remains. This was the zone where the unburnt charge remains in no swirl case. And when you have high swirl, see, you are here, and if the swirl is very high, this is at 10 degree, this is at 15 degree, this is at 20 degree, and this is at 30 degree. So this will be the charge which will remain unburned. So you see how the unburned charge is moving. Depending on the swirl, location of the unburned charge is moving. The second experiment was done. So this is the case where the spark plug is on side of the combustion chamber. So people thought that, you know, why not put the spark plug in the center? So they developed a special spark plug, and now in this case, the spark is taking place in the center. So this is no swirl case, single spark. So you see, this is at 10 degree, this is at 20, this is at 30, and here 20 and 25, everything is consumed. So here you can see the flame speed is much faster compared to any of these three. Then people also explored that, okay, let us have two points of ignition. So two sparks side by side. So you see here 20 degree, these two sparks, the flame fronts are colliding, and this is 25 degree, entire thing is engulfed. So these were some experiments done in former times. So combustion in SI engine, it is very, very clear that it is basically in the turbulent flow field. Okay, approximately spherical development of the flame front from the vicinity of the spark plug takes place. So this is approximately spherical. The geometry of the combustion chamber and spark plug govern the flame front surface area. Larger is the surface area, greater is the mass of the fresh charge that cross the surface and enters the flame zone. The center plug location gives twice the flame area of side flame geometry and burns twice as fast. So you can see here, even half of the combustion chamber is burnt at up to 25. But here you see even at 20, almost entire thing is gone. Okay, so it's very fast. Mixture burning rate is highly influenced by the engine speed, because engine speed is going to increase the turbulence and also filling and emptying process of the combustion chamber. Now there were a lot of experiments done on laminar burning speeds. The laminar burning speeds are, laminar conditions never exist inside the combustion chamber, but it's very important to understand the laminar flame speeds, because that will give you some idea about what is going to happen in case of turbulence also. Turbulence speed of course depend on how much is the turbulence. Okay, so people have done these experiments under simulated conditions where you create laminar mixtures and there you create laminar conditions. And here you see it is the fuel air mixture with equivalence ratio varying from 0.6 to 1.6. This side is the richer side, okay, phi, and this side is the leaner side. And here people have measured burning velocity. So what is seen is that you see this first figure is methanol. So from the lean side you can burn up to 1.2. Beyond 1.2 there is no data point. That means it is not possible to ignite more than 1.2 phi richer mixture. Propane on the other hand went up to 1.4. This is gasoline, and this also shows that gasoline flame speed is generally lower than propane and it is lower than methanol. Methanol flame speeds are fastest among these three fuels. And this is iso-octane or gasoline. Iso-octane is slightly lower than gasoline. Okay. Now, you see this figure shows four different cycles where flame radius is shown. The radius of the flame, how it is changing with time or with crank angle. So crank angle is shown here. And these are four different cycles, engine cycles. So one thing is very clear, you see that in the engine, particularly spark engine, there is a lot of cyclic variability. You can see if there was no cyclic variability, these should actually overlap. If one cycle is exactly same as the next cycle and next cycle is exactly same as the previous cycle, then you know they should overlap. But this very clearly shows that with time, as the time is changing, the radius, the flame radius is actually increasing. This shows burnt gas radius with flame radius. Flame radius is the outer radius. This almost linear. Variation in flame geometry and velocity parameters during four individual combustion cycles are shown here. This shows the cyclic variations in combustion and partial burning and misfire. You see, this is the P theta diagram. So from an engine, we have taken 5 or 10 different measurements. And you see these are 10 different measurements. So in the lowest pressure is about 25-26 bar, highest is 35-36 bars. So now the question is that if you have an engine where the cyclic variability is so large, which one should you analyze for combustion analysis? The one which is low or the one which is high? Okay. If you analyze the lower one, this is the heat release. So this is the peak heat release. If you analyze the higher one, this is the heat release. So you can see that, you know, it is very confusing. Which one do you take? So in order to avoid such a situation where we are not able to take a decision on which one to analyze, what we do is we take a large number of cycles data. So we take 250 cycles, 500 cycles, 1000 cycles. Okay. So now once you have acquired 1000 cycles, and then you take an average of that and then you analyze it. And then if you take next 1000 cycles and average it, you will find that the difference between the two averages is negligible. or the, it will not be there. They will be exactly same. Okay. So whenever we do combustion analysis, we never acquire the combustion data for one or two cycles. We always acquire for large number of cycles, which should be more than 200 to 250 cycle minimum. Okay. And then we do the heat release analysis. So if we look at the cycle by cycle variations, so pressure related parameters are there, burn rate related parameters are there, flame front position parameters are there. So all these vary because of the cyclic variability. This figure shows the maximum pressure and crank angle degree. Now you see, when the engine speed, suppose you are operating the engine and you are applying different maximum brake torque timing, and once you are running the engine at slow speed, okay, so slow speed means slow burn, and once you are running the engine at fast speed, see, if you look at any motorbike engine, you can run at 1000 rpm, you can also run it at 5000 rpm. So once you do 5000 rpm, that means the entire, how much time is available for completing one cycle? It will be 1/5 of what is available for 1000 rpm. So fast burn characteristics and slow burn characteristics are very, very different from each other. Okay, similarly, this figure shows indicated mean effective pressure versus crank angle degree. So you can see that cyclic variability is quite large in case of spark ignition engines. Cycle by cycle variations seen from the beginning of the combustion process. Dispersion in burning rates is evident throughout the combustion process. What are the causes of this dispersion? One is the variation in gas motion in cylinder during the combustion in every cycle. So how the gas is going to move, that is going to be different from one cycle to another cycle. Second is that there is variation in amount of air fuel mixture and recycled exhaust gas. See, in the engine, when we are operating the valve, sometimes the valve hits the seat and then it jumps a little bit. So some more gas may escape, exhaust gas may escape. The amount of exhaust gas that is left in the combustion chamber is different from one cycle to another cycle. So therefore, the amount of fuel air mixture coming in will also be different, and therefore the combustion, the composition of the charge inside the combustion chamber will also be different from cycle to cycle. Okay, so variation of amount of fuel air mixture and recycled exhaust gas given to a particular cylinder in each cycle can be different, and then there will be difference in mixture composition within the cylinder. So inside the cylinder also, one zone may be more having richer mixture, the other zone may be having leaner mixture. It's possible it's not completely homogeneous. So this is shown very, very clearly in this figure. This shows the air fuel ratio and this is the cycle number. Okay, so you can see that the air fuel ratio, which was supposed to be 18, was never 18. It was either 17 or 18.5, and it was continuously varying between different cycles. Okay, then, you know, this is the relationship between carbon dioxide and unburnt hydrocarbon just prior to ignition. Where is the carbon dioxide concentration coming from? It is from the gas left from the previous cycle. Where is the hydrocarbon concentration coming from? It is also from the gas, from the mixture left in the previous cycle, plus the fuel, fresh fuel, that is also counted as hydrocarbon. So you see here, this is the HC concentration and this is the CO2 concentration. And you will see that it varies. It varies from 5% to 3%, and the hydrocarbon concentration varies from 9.5 to 11 into 10 to the power 4 ppm of carbon. Okay, so when you have such a large variation in the mixture concentration, obviously you can expect them to produce different power output. You can expect them to have different maximum in cylinder pressure or P theta diagram. Okay, so I hope I have explained what are the reasons of cyclic variability inside the spark ignition. Now let's look at abnormal combustion. So there are two types of combustion. One is normal combustion, the other one is abnormal combustion. Whatever combustion we cannot call normal combustion, that ends up being called as a abnormal combustion. Let's first understand what is normal combustion. So normal combustion is basically a process which is initiated solely by a timed spark. So that means it is initiated by a spark which you have timed, in which the flame front moves completely across the combustion chamber in a uniform manner at a normal velocity. So you applied the spark at the time that you wanted, and the flame front moves from the spark plug to the piston in a normal manner with a normal velocity and consumes the entire charge. That's normal combustion. Any variation in this is called abnormal combustion. So abnormal combustion is a combustion process in which a flame front may be started by a hot combustion chamber surface either prior to or after the spark ignition. So either you ignite before or after, but you have some additional source of ignition, or a process in which some part of the charge may be consumed at extremely high rates. Extremely high rates means the last part which is left out, it detonates. So that's called abnormal combustion. And then there are two main types of abnormal combustion. One is the spark knock, the other one is called surface ignition. What is spark knock? Spark knock is recurrent and repeatable in terms of audibility. You can hear it. It is repeatable. And you can hear it. I am sure all of you must have driven bike, motorbike. So when you are running your bike at 20 kilometers an hour and you are in third or fourth gear, and there is a separate, you know, hammering, very special metallic noise that comes, and then that's called spark knock. And then what you do, you change the gear and bring the vehicle to the lower gear. So that's the audible knock. Okay, so a knock which is recurrent and repeatable in terms of audibility. It is controlled by spark advance. Advancing the spark increases the knock intensity, and retarding the spark reduces the intensity. Okay, so if you are advancing the spark, the knocking will increase. If you are retarding the spark, then the intensity will reduce. Surface ignition. Surface ignition is a ignition of fuel air mixture by any hot surface other than the spark discharge prior to the arrival of normal flame front. It may occur before the spark ignites the charge or after the normal ignition. If it happens before, it's called pre-ignition. If it happens after the normal ignition, it's called post-ignition. So basically, in the combustion chamber, if there is a carbon deposit or if there is a casting defect, you cast the cylinder liner. If there is a bubble inside the casting, then what will happen? That area, the heat will not be able to transfer, right? Because there is a bubble behind it. Are you getting my point? If this is your cylinder liner, okay, you have made it by casting. Suppose there is a bubble here in the casting defect. So now the heat that will transfer from this side will move smoothly. The temperature here will reduce. But in this zone, since there is air bubble, the heat will not be able to go. So this area of the liner will become hotter, and it will become so hot that it may start igniting the fuel air mixture. So this is called surface ignition. If this ignition happens before the normal spark ignites, then it is called pre-ignition. If it happens afterwards, then it is called post-ignition. Okay. So abnormal combustion features are of concern because when severe, they can cause major engine damage. Even if they are not severe, they are objectionable source of noise. So these are the reasons. So for example, you know, this figure shows very, very interesting observations. So you see, this is the flame front, 18.83 Kankangal degree. And here you see, this is the unburned charge. Okay, this is the flame front that is moving. This is the section of the combustion chamber. This is the charge that is getting compressed more and more by this flame front. So this will be the zone where charge will explode, auto ignite, and you can see this charge burns, and before it moves, there is a strong flame front which will be generated because of the auto ignition of this. So these are the auto ignition sites very close to the extreme end of the cylinder combustion chamber, and then, you know, the ignition can happen, auto ignition can happen. So this is called knock. Now let me explain why this happens. Okay. So see, this is the stoichiometric mixture. On this axis you have air fuel ratio 0 to 30 or 40. So if you go on this side, it is lean. If you go on this side, it is rich. This is the stoichiometric mixture. This is a zone from 9 to 21, which is practical limit for carbureted engines. Okay. 7 to 30 is basically the ignition limit for hydrocarbon. If you are richer than 7, then it will not burn because it is too rich. It's outside the flammability limit. If you are leaner than 30, then it will not burn because it is too lean to burn. If you look at the air fuel ratio, see, this is stoichiometric. So stoichiometric gives you, this is the richer side, this is the leaner side. So as you make the mixture little richer, so mixture slightly richer than stoichiometric will give you maximum power. Okay. Mixture which is either stoichiometric or slightly leaner than stoichiometric will give you maximum best fuel consumption, best mileage. Okay. If you are slightly leaner than stoichiometric, then you get maximum NOx. NOx is low at richer mixture, NOx is also low for leaner mixture, because in those both conditions peak temperature is lower. Carbon monoxide is higher if you have rich mixture. If you have lean, carbon monoxide will be very, very low. Hydrocarbons, it is high for richer mixtures and it again increases for leaner mixtures. Why? Because as you go lean, the chances of misfire are more, and once the misfire takes place, combustion will not take place and the entire fuel, which is hydrocarbon, will go out without getting completely burnt. Okay. So ignition of the charge is only possible within certain limits of the air fuel ratio. Stoichiometric is about 14.5 to 15. Ignition limit for hydrocarbon must lie between 7 to 30. Okay. The lower and upper ignition limits of the mixture depend on the mixture ratio and the temperature. The ignition limits are wider at increased temperature if you are at higher temperature. So inside the engine we always have higher temperature. So normally the air fuel ratio limits are wider because of the higher rates of reaction and higher thermal diffusivity coefficients of the constituents of the mixture. So you see, let's first look at the power output. So power output means that you are actually your flame speeds are fast and you are able to create higher pressure. Higher pressure force is being transferred to the piston. So these are actually highest for slightly richer mixture. Fuel consumption is lowest. In this case, you will be emitting lot of hydrocarbon and carbon monoxide. So lot of fuel will go unburned, but you are interested in more power output. In mixtures which are slightly lean, what happens is that you have slightly more air available. So whatever residual carbon monoxide hydrocarbons are there, you will burn all of them. The heat will be released. So more heat will be utilized to produce power output. That is why specific fuel consumption is low. Okay. So in the spark ignition systems, the spark plug is a device for delivering electrical current from an ignition source to the combustion chamber of a spark ignition system. As you can see here, two electrodes, and there is a ceramic here. So this is one electrode, this is another electrode. Okay. And these two are separated by very high quality insulator, alumina. Okay. So basically you need a high voltage to break down for the breakdown in the spark plug. A low source impedance for steep voltage rise. You want the voltage to rise suddenly so that the plasma formation takes place. A high energy capacity to create spark kernel of sufficient size and sufficient duration of the voltage pulse to ensure that the ignition is certain. So this is done by such a system. You have these spark plugs which are mounted on different cylinders in the cylinder head. These are connected via a distributor. So distributor ensures which cylinder will fire when, and this contact actually is connected to the crankshaft. Okay, so only one cylinder will be firing at a time. This is what is ensured by this distributor. If you look at this side, here you have the contactor, which is nothing but the key which the driver places. So basically, by doing it, the driver is making a contact between the battery and the ignition coil. Okay, so battery gives current to the ignition coil, and then here you have a system which is basically a contact breaker, a capacitor, and a coil. So this system basically generates a very high voltage pulse, and there is sufficient capacity is provided by capacitor. So it basically gets charged and then it gets discharged. And this ignition coil, it's a transformer. So what, it's a step up transformer. So 12 volts is converted into 35,000 volts, and that is supplied to distributor, and from this it is given to electrode, and that's where the discharge takes place. So this is the overall schematic of how a spark ignition system of a spark ignition engine works. If you look at the construction of the spark plug, this is one terminal, okay, where you are basically putting your high voltage supply, okay, and this part, this hex part, is attached to the body. It acts as another ground basically. Okay, so this is the ground, and in the center you have this electrode, and here you have the gap. Okay, and here the temperature, how much temperature you can create by this? You can create temperatures as high as 10,000 degree centigrade. Now at 10,000 degree centigrade, even metals will start evaporating. That's why this material at the electrode gap is a special material which should not evaporate or degenerate because of these repeated heating and cooling cycles. So, and this should be highly conducting, and this should there is also a provision where, because the engine will get heated, so there will be thermal expansion. So there is a provision to absorb that thermal expansion this electrode. Okay, so there are many types of electrodes are there. There are different metals are there that are used. Okay, so for a spark to jump across an air gap of 0.6, 0.5, 0.6, 0.7 millimeter of in an engine cylinder having a compression ratio of 8:1, approximately 8,000 volts is required. So this is basically a very small engine with small compression ratio. Okay, so here the 12 volt has to be converted to 8 to 20 kilovolt, and has to deliver the voltage at right cylinder at the right time, and that is ensured by distributor system. Okay, about 0.2 millijoule of energy is required to ignite a stoichiometric mixture at normal engine operating condition by a spark. Over 3 millijoule is required for rich or lean mixtures. So you can see that stoichiometric require very less, but when the mixture actually becomes lean or rich, the amount of energy required is very high. Now in order to make sure what you want the spark to be 100% sure. So what you do is you always over design. So you design your system such that 30 to 50 millijoule of electrical energy is given in the electrode. Okay, so this is as far as the conventional spark is concerned. Now there is something I would like to introduce, which is laser ignition. And in laser ignition, you are basically generating plasma. Here we are generating plasma by electrical spark, but in laser ignition, laser is also photon. So you concentrate the photon at one point very sharply, and then you can generate plasma, which is in this case is 2 times hotter. So here the laser generated plasma is about 1 million degree Kelvin temperature. Okay, in the spark plug, when you generate plasma, the shock wave that you are generating, the pressure that is created is about 100 bar in case of spark plug. In case of laser spark plug, it is 1000 bar to 10,000 bar. So it is much more intense compared to laser, compared to conventional spark ignition. So laser ignition is an alternative method for igniting compressed gaseous mixtures of fuel and air. Method is based on laser device that produces short but powerful flashes regardless of the pressure in the combustion chamber. So the advantage, there are many advantages of laser ignition. First is that there is possibility of free positioning of the plasma. See, in case of spark ignition, your plasma, your electrodes will be very close to the cylinder head. If you want to put it in the center of the combustion chamber, it's not possible, right? But in case of laser ignition, it's possible. You can place it wherever you want. You just need to change the focal length of the lens. Okay, there is no electrode erosion effect. I told you that temperatures are so high that electrodes start getting evaporated. Okay, there is no problem here because you are generating plasma in the space. Feasibility of igniting linear mixtures together with high ignition pressures, which ultimately results in higher efficiency. So this, you can burn linear mixtures which are not possible to be burned by spark ignition. Nowadays, you know, in order to meet the emission norms, the trend is that you want to burn linear and linear mixtures and you want to boost the engine so that you put the same amount of fuel. Lean, more amount of air, more amount of fuel. So efficiency is high, emissions are low. But linear mixtures, you know, you have difficulty using spark plug. Laser is spark plug, it's very easy to ignite. Then high precision in ignition timing because light travels faster than electrical signals. So you can control it much better. Possibility of multiple ignition allows the ignition to be initiated at two or more plasma sparks at multiple locations at the same time, which leads to reduction in distance of maximum flame travel, shorten the combustion duration. Now, this is just one example, okay? This is the electrical spark and this is the laser spark. You can see this is here and you can see this here. What does it show? Where the temperatures will be high? Obviously, in case of laser ignition. So when the mixture is ignited, spark energy must be higher than the minimum energy of ignition of the mixture. Distance between the electrodes is larger than the extinguishing distance for a given mixture, and local gradient of velocity is smaller than the critical for a given mixture. So in essence, I will tell you that suppose you have a combustion chamber and you are putting a spark here. What is the maximum distance of flame travel? Okay. So if you want to make your engine run fast, what you need to do? You can actually, instead of one, you can put two spark plugs. So now your maximum distance of flame travel will reduce. Okay. So that means the combustion that is taking place will be faster. Time taken in combustion will be lower. So coming to the laser ignition, what is possible is, in laser ignition what you do is, you have a laser coming in and then you have a lens, and this lens can focus and here the plasma is generated. Okay. What you can also do is, you can put a something like a grating. So what that grating will do is, it will make part of the energy come here, here and here. So that one laser will lead to three or four or two separate ignition points. So once you have this, that means obviously the distance of maximum travel will be reduced as well. So this of course is, right now it is not commercially available as of now, it is all in research stages of now. So this is one of the advantage of laser ignition. Coming back to combustion in SI engines, if you look at the P-theta diagram, so this is the motoring diagram and this is the firing diagram. This is the point A where you have applied the spark, okay? And this is the point when the motoring curve starts separating from the firing curve. and this is the point where you have the peak pressure, and this is the point where mostly you feel that, you know, most of the heat release has taken place. So this curve can actually be divided into three parts. One is this AB, which is what? Ignition delay. Then B to C is basically the propagation of flames, and C to D is afterburning. Okay. So let's look at ignition delay. What is ignition delay? So there is a time interval between the instant a spark is applied and the instant where there is a noticeable rise in the pressure due to combustion. This is called ignition delay. Okay. Ignition delay is the time interval in the process of chemical reaction during which the molecules of fuel air mixture, they get heated up to self ignition temperature, they get ignited and produce a self propagating nucleus of flames. So the flames start moving. Ignition delay is very, very small, and it lies between 50 milliseconds to 20 milliseconds. An ignition delay of 20 milliseconds corresponds to 35 degree crank angle rotation when the engine is operating at 3000 RPM. Sorry, this is not 15, this is 0.15 millisecond to 0.2 millisecond or 150 microsecond to 200 microsecond. Once the flame is formed, it should be self-sustained and must be able to propagate through the mixture. This is possible when the rate of heat generation by burning is greater than the heat lost by the flame to the surrounding. I told you that flames will sustain only when the heat generation is more and heat loss is less. The moment heat loss is more, the flames will get extinguished. The starting point of the second stage, where the first noticeable rise in the pressure can be seen on the indicator diagram, is that point. This stage is called as the main stage, and about 80 to 90% energy is released in this stage, 80 to 90%. And the remaining is in the afterburning. So combustion does not terminate at this point, and afterburning continues for a long time near the walls or behind the turbulent flame fronts. The combustion rate at this stage reduces due to surface of the flame front becoming small and the reactions in the turbulence also becomes weak. About 10% of the heat is released in this phase, and it's not really, it doesn't have much consequences on the combustion. Now let's look at the combustion flame speeds. In a spark ignition engine, the flame speed is a very, very important parameter, and there are many, many parameters or many, many factors that influence the flame speed. First factor that influences turbulence, second factor that influences the flame speed is temperature and pressure, and the third factor that influences the flame speed is engine speed. So obviously, when the turbulence increases, the heat flow to the cylinder walls also increases, and this accelerates the chemical reaction by intimately mixing the fuel with the air, with the oxygen, and so that the spark advance can be reduced. This helps in burning the leaner mixture. If the turbulence is more, you will be able to burn leaner mixtures. The increase in the flame speed due to turbulence reduces the combustion duration. If the turbulence is more, the combustion flames will be fast, that the duration will be less. Hence, there will be minimum tendency for abnormal combustion. So if the flame speed is fast, you will be able to consume the last part of the charge very effectively. So sometimes, you know, as I told you that, you know, if you're running the engine at 20 kilometer an hour in fourth gear, so your engine is actually operating at a very small speed. So what you do, you change the gear. So by changing the gear, what you are doing is you are increasing the engine speed. So when the engine speed increases, what happens? The turbulence inside the combustion chamber also increases, and that's what is able to control the abnormal combustion inside the combustion chamber. Pressure and temperature. The flame speed increases with increase in intake temperature and pressure. Higher will be the temperature and pressure, more will be the flame speed. At higher initial pressure and temperature may help to form a better homogeneous mixture, which helps in increasing the flame speed. Okay. So this is possible because of an overall increase in density of the charge. So higher will be the density, more will be the flame speed. Engine speed, as I said, engine speed and turbulence are related to each other. Lower will be the engine speed, less will be the turbulence. So flame speed increases almost linearly with the engine speed. Since the increase in engine speed increases the turbulence inside the combustion chamber. Now these are some view graphs from a actually a optical engine. Okay. Now the problem is that, you know, homogeneous fuel air mixture, when you are burning, there is hardly any soot formation. So it is very difficult to see the flames, you know, capture the flames on the camera. So what you have to do is you have to put some kind of additives which glow and gives you this kind of a shine. Otherwise, in a normal engine, it's very difficult to capture gasoline flames. So you apply the spark at say minus 30. Don't see anything till minus 20, and then after minus 20 you start seeing something, and then it starts growing. Okay, by the time you come to the top dead center, almost 2/3 of the combustion chamber of the cylinder bore is occupied by the flames. Then it's keep on moving, and like 18-20 it is at the peak, and then after 30 it starts diminishing. So you see here minus 15 to plus 30, combustion is over in spark ignition engine. Fuel air ratio also affects the flame speed. Fuel air ratio has a very significant influence on the flame speed. The highest flame speeds are obtained with somewhat richer mixture. Now coming back to this question about the power output, this is also affected by the flame speed. Okay, flame speeds are fastest. When the mixture is made leaner or richer, the flame speed on both sides is going to be decreasing. Okay, less thermal energy is released in case of lean mixture, resulting in lower flame temperature. Very rich mixture lead to incomplete combustion, which results in release of heat, lower heat energy. So when you have rich mixture, obviously there is not enough oxygen available, and if there is not enough oxygen available, the combustion will remain incomplete. You will have lot of formation of carbon monoxide and hydrocarbons. Other factors that affect is engine output. The cycle pressure increases when the engine output is increased. Obviously, because you are putting in more amount of fuel, so pressure inside the combustion chamber will also be higher. With the increased throttle opening of the cylinder gets filled with higher density, and this results in increased flame speed. If you have higher compression ratio, obviously when you have higher compression ratio engine, the pressure and temperature will be higher as well, and when the pressure and temperature will be higher, the flame velocity will be also higher. Okay, engine size. So engine size really does not have much effect on the flame speed. In large engines, the time required to complete the combustion is more, because the flames have to travel longer distance. If suppose this bore is large and this stroke is large, they will take more time because the speed is almost constant. So that is why even this larger spark ignition engine, larger will be the spark ignition engine, slower it will be in terms of RPM. Okay. So this requires increased crank angle duration for combustion to get complete. This is one of the reasons why large size engines are designed to operate at low speeds. Okay, clear? Now let's look at the abnormal combustion. So knocking, or called detonation, is in spark ignition engine occurs when combustion of air fuel mixture in cylinder does not start correctly in response to ignition. But one or more pockets of air fuel mixture explode outside the envelope of normal combustion flame front. So combustion flame front is moving separately, there is extra packets that are burning separately, that causes knocking to happen. So it may be prevented by some of the techniques that I'm going to discuss now. First is that you can use fuel with higher octane rating. Higher octane rating means the fuel will have longer ignition delay. So longer ignition delay will allow the flame front to consume the remaining charge. Okay, this increases the combustion temperature of the fuel and reduces the proactivity to detonate. Enrichment of the fuel air mixture, which alters the chemical reactions during combustion, it reduces the combustion temperature and increases the margin above the detonation. And then by reducing the peak cylinder pressure. How? If your engine is boosted, you reduce the boost, or if you have the possibility of changing the compression ratio at the design stage, you can reduce the compression ratio. You can decrease the manifold pressure by reducing the throttle opening or by reducing the boost pressure. Reducing the load on the engine also helps you control the knocking, or retarding the ignition timing. Okay, so if you make a later spark, that will also help you control the ignition. So knocking should not be confused with pre-ignition. Pre-ignition and knocking, these are two separate events. However, pre-ignition is usually followed by knocking. Let's discuss what is pre-ignition. Pre-ignition in a spark ignition engine is technically different phenomena from engine knocking and describes the event where the air-fuel mixture in the cylinder ignites before the spark plug fires. So pre-ignition means you have not even ignited the, you have not even applied the spark, but combustion starts uncontrollably. That's called pre-ignition. How? It may happen because of several reasons. One reason could be that there could be deposits in the cylinder, carbon deposits, which may be hot enough to start the ignition. Or, you know, in the spark plug also, you are applying this high voltage. Now, spark plug, you know, this one electrode which is turned, it has very large surface area and it has small volume. So that means it will get heated, but the heat will not be transferred that quickly. So that means it will remain very, very hot. It may even get red hot. So it may also uncontrollably ignite the mixture. So pre-ignition can be caused by deposits. It can be caused by casting defects in the cylinder hood or the top part of the combustion chamber. It can also be caused by spark plug electrode. So carbon deposits, they form as a heat barrier, and they could be contributing factor to the pre-ignition. Other causes are overheated spark plug, glowing carbon deposits on the hot exhaust valve. So these are some of the reasons that can cause pre-ignition. A sharp edge on the combustion chamber or top edge of the piston can also be source of pre-ignition. Sharp edges on the valve that were reground improperly can also be the cause. A lean fuel mixture can be the cause. Engine that is running hotter than normal due to cooling system problem. If your cooling system is having a problem and you are not able to remove the heat, then the engine will run hot, all the parts will run hotter. That may cause pre-ignition. Okay, for example, there could be low coolant level, there could be, you know, slipping fan clutch and fan is not operating properly, or inoperative electric cooling fan or other cooling system problems. So any of these things can also cause pre-ignition problems. Now, this is what I wanted to explain this to you, the phenomena of knock in spark ignition engine, how it happens. So suppose this is the combustion chamber and this is the spark plug here, and this side is the piston. Okay, so you apply the spark, so what will happen? The flame front will move in a semicircular manner. Okay, and then this is the flame front. So behind this is the burnt charge, this is the unburnt charge. Now when the flame front moves, flame front, what it does is it releases, the heat is released. So the what it does is it compresses the unburnt charge. So when it is compressing it, the pressure and temperature will further rise. So suppose, you know, this flame front, it has reached here and this part has reached auto ignition temperature. Now once the fuel air mixture reaches the auto ignition temperature, then it will detonate after the elapse of delay period, right? Because reaching the auto ignition temperature is not enough, delay period also has to be elapsed. So during the delay period, if this flame front is able to move and reach up to point D, then really there will be no charge left to auto ignite. Then it will lead to normal combustion. So this kind of a smooth P theta diagram you will obtain. Suppose you are reach here and this part has reached the auto ignition temperature, but the delay period is not elapsed, and in that delay period, suppose this flame front BB dash is only able to come to CC dash. So now this charge which is contained in CC dash D portion, this will be at auto ignition temperature and the delay period is over. So what will happen? This part will explode. So once this part explodes, the one pressure wave moving in the direction, another pressure moving in this direction, they will collide. And that will give rise to fluctuations in pressure, which is nothing but knocking in the spark ignition engine. Okay? So this is the phenomena of knocking in the spark ignition engine. Okay? This is this is combustion without knock and this is combustion with knock. All right. So the temperature at the end of the charge has not reached its self ignition temperature, the charge would not auto ignite. Flame will advance further and consume the charge BB dash T. This is the normal combustion process. And if it is not able to go all the way, if it reaches only up to CC dash, then CC dash D will auto ignite and this is called knocking. I think I have already explained this to you.